Why are polyunsaturated fats more easily burned for energy than saturated fats?
Hi, I'm Chris Masterjohn, and I have a PhD in nutritional sciences. I am not a medical doctor, and nothing contained in this episode may be construed as medical or nutritional advice of any kind or a substitute, therefore. This episode is meant purely as scientific education. If you wish to act on any ideas presented in this episode, please consult your physician first and never take anything herein as a reason to contradict medical advice. With that said, enjoy the episode. This anonymous says, why are long-chain unsaturated fats more easily beta-oxidized than long-chain saturated fats? What is the mechanism behind this? Also, during extended fasting, predominantly more unsaturated and longer-chain fatty acids are released from lipolysis. Why do you think this is? So the long-chain unsaturated fats, I don't know in detail the mechanism, but I do know that that's been shown in human cells and in live animal experiments. And it presumably is related to the affinity of the enzyme for the fatty acid. And that's not something that's biochemically difficult. It's sort of, it's normal if there are, it's normal if there are enzymes that work with any fatty acid for them to have different affinities for some fatty acids versus others. It would actually be highly strange if there weren't at least some differences in the affinity of an enzyme for dozens of different substrates. So I'm guessing, this is my guess, but I'm guessing that it's because there's different affinity for the enzymes. But what I can tell you is that it's been shown in human cells and in animal experiments. And there's also human trials that seem to that seem very consistent with it. So, for example, the fact that short-term two-week trials show that polyunsaturated fats can lead to lower liver triglycerides than saturated fats is very consistent with the idea that they are more easily beta-oxidized. So I think it's a clinically relevant, physiologically relevant phenomenon. In terms of, so there's two ways to answer the question why, and I think your first part of that question was focusing mechanistically why, what's the mechanism behind this? But then there's the sort of like, why would it happen that way? And it's my opinion that it happens that way because it's advantageous to get rid of polyunsaturated fatty acids beyond the requirement for essentiality. And this is really convincing in rats and mice because they not only burn them for energy at a higher rate, but they also turn them into saturated fatty acids and they expel them into their fur at very high rates. And so they really, really seem to want to do anything they can to get rid of PUFAs beyond the requirement for essential fatty acids. And to me, that's sort of obvious why that's the case, because you have certain minimal requirement for it, but they're at any amount, they're an oxidative liability. So why would you want your tissues to be easily oxidized? Why would you want that liability any higher than it has to be to maintain essential physiological functions? You wouldn't. So it's, I see it as a straightforward explanation that you just want to get rid of fatty acids that are a liability to have around. And that doesn't mean they're not essential. It just means that you don't want more than you need. During your second part of your question is during extended fasting, predominantly more unsaturated and longer chain fatty acids are released from lipolysis. I don't know the answer to that question, but I suspect the answer is the same. Is the same as what I just said for why they're beta oxidized at a higher rate. And it would be weird if they were beta oxidized at a higher rate, but they were not released at a higher rate for beta oxidation. It would be totally possible, but it would be a cleaner functioning system if the goal is to get rid of the ones beyond what you need and you had half the system working in favor of that beta oxidation, but lipolysis, the other half of that system, was not working. So my suspicion, it's just a suspicion, it's just an opinion, is that's what's going on. Thank you, Anonymous, for your question. Pippa A says, going back to what you said about PUFA being preferentially oxidized, that is very interesting, but begs the question, why does stored adipose PUFA increase in proportion of dietary intake? Wouldn't it be preferentially oxidized rather than stored? If you're storing fat, it's because you're eating too much. I mean, it's not entirely true. Like, you're always going to store some fat, but generally when you're storing fat, you know, if I eat 2,000 calories today, to some extent, the adipose PUFA is going to increase as kind of collateral damage of the normal flux that there is always generalized lipolysis and resynthesis of triglycerides going on in the liver. And if during that process, I'm, you know, getting dietary fatty acids in there, they're going to get mixed in somehow, some way. But in terms of, you know, why would there be significant, very meaningful, net accretion of those dietary PUFAs? That's generally going to be because I'm already fulfilling my requirements for energy with other things. And that other things is generally carbohydrate. Generally, carbohydrate is preferentially burned for energy. And you know, you might say, well, why don't you preferentially burn the PUFAs for energy instead of the carbohydrate? Well, good luck storing 40 pounds of glycogen. I mean, you just can't do it, right? You can store endless amounts of fat and you can't store glycogen. And so I think there are probably other reasons why glucose is preferentially burned there, because there are advantages to burning glucose. It is more versatile as a fuel than fat is, in terms of the things that can be done with it. Like, fat can't enter the pentose phosphate pathway to support antioxidant defense and nutrient recycling and anabolic synthesis. Fat can't be anaplerotic by allowing the Krebs cycle to run. Glucose can do those things. But, you know, at the end of the day, if you have to store some of the energy you ate and you have to burn some of the energy you ate, you're going to store the fat because there is no end to the supply of fat you can carry around. And there's a pretty strong cap on the amount of glycogen you can carry around. Therefore, you're going to burn the carbs for energy and store the fat if you eat enough food to replace the fat. And if you're in a hypercaloric diet and you're gaining fat over time, then you're going to accrete more of the PUFA in the fat than if you were in a eucaloric diet and your fat was stable, but you happened to get some of those fatty acids mixed in to get stored in adipose tissue. So the body doesn't have one priority to get rid of PUFA. It has inconceivably high number of priorities. And so you can't always prioritize getting rid of the PUFA. And storing the PUFA in adipose tissue is a lot safer than storing it in your cell membranes. Because at the end of the day, if you have to soak up more vitamin E to protect the PUFA in adipose tissue, that's better than having lipid peroxidation chain reactions in the cell membranes and damaging the function of proteins, damaging your metabolism, and making your cells fall apart. So adipose storage of PUFA is not that bad of an option, all things considered. All right, thank you, Pippa, for your question.
This episode was part of a Q&A for members of the CMJ MasterPass, a buyer's club with exclusive and massive discounts on your favorite premium foods and health products, including pasture-raised and wild meat and seafood, supplements, sleep accessories, water filters, phototherapy devices, and much more. As a bonus, you also get to participate in monthly private Zoom Q&As with me. You can join the MasterPass at chrismasterjohnphd.com/masterpass and use the code Q&A, spelled out as Q-A-N-D-A, Q&A, for a 10% lifetime discount.
From now through February or March, whatever it takes to get it done, I will be working full-time on finishing my Vitamins and Minerals 101 book while reserving a portion of my time for my consulting clients. You can pre-order my book at chrismasterjohnphd.com/book. In my consulting, I am neither a medical practitioner nor a coach. I serve as your data analyst and your strategist. I teach you scientific principles of health and wellness, help you analyze your data, and help brainstorm actionable strategies. You can sign up for a consultation at chrismasterjohnphd.com/consultations. I will try to respond to comments here when I can, but my presence will be intermittent while I'm finishing my book. I hope you enjoyed this, and I will see you in the next episode.